green line. Live from Los Angeles. Tonight's special guests, Sammy Hagar and Dick Cavett.
Welcome. What an exciting show we have today. Dick Cavett is here with us, and Sammy Hagar, together at last. And I don't...
Oh, together again. We were in grade school together in Nebraska.
Oh, really? Yeah.
It's Sammy... absolute bull.
Yeah, you can swear here. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Shit.
But this is very... This is very exciting for me, though. Everybody who does a talk show has great reverence for you, sir. It's so great to have you
dear.
Here. You could probably count on one hand the amount of people who have had an impact on television, as much of an impact as you.
Well, I tried to take some impact from my heaven, my God, Jack Parr. I don't think I ever missed a Jack Parr show before I worked for Jack Parr. And that fact, oh, there we are. That fact made me feel like I had, you know, gone through the looking glass like Alice into another world that was the one I always knew I wanted to be in. I didn't want to be a talk show host. You have to be crazy to want that. But, and there weren't such things when I first, I just wanted to be in show business. I didn't care what kind.
So,
and getting in, suddenly I was on the other side of the screen working for Jack.
So when Jack.
Never dreamed of being a host.
Yeah. Yeah, when Jack Parr came on TV, there really hadn't been television like that before.
Well, there'd been a show with a kind of a Borscht-style comic named Jerry Lester and a statuous blonde named Dagmar that was on five nights a week. Then the great Steve Allen came along and held the post for a long time. But people think of Jack as the first big classic Tonight Show host, yeah.
He was the first guy that really talked to the guests, had authors on and people that would really...
Yeah.
Am I correct about that? Is he? Was
you
he,
are when you said talk, because when I started, having worked for him and then John Interbeck, and he called me and he said, he was retired by then, he said, hey, kid, you're going to do a talk show, don't do interviews. And I thought, well, what do I do, sing or, you know, play music or read poetry to them? He said, no, no, interviews, you know, Q&A. What's your favorite this? David Frost and his damn clipboard, reading him with jet lag. Who's your favorite this? Make it a conversation, he said. And that really, you know, when it becomes talk, you can almost forget you're on television,
yeah.
As I did a couple times.
Yeah.
Failed to go to commercial. But yeah, it should be called conversation shows, probably. The
yeah.
British call them chat shows.
Yeah. I noticed when you had, like, David Bowie on, for instance, in
yeah.
1974. And
was it?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, probably.
You know, there were moments where he just seemed very nervous. You even started, are you nervous, you're asking.
Well, he had some kind of case of sniffles, didn't
mm-hmm.
he?
Mm-hmm. And he kept playing.
What a hip audience.
He kept playing with his cane.
Yeah.
He was sort of very out of his element.
I liked Bowie, and I met him other times, had him on, but yeah, he was interesting that way. My best moment with a rock person, you might call them, well, that sounds like what Richard Nixon would call them, wasn't it?
A rock person, yes.
These entertainers, as we call them.
Yeah.
George Harrison. Somebody had said, now, Cavett, you're really trying to get 90 minutes out of George Harrison, good luck. And I saw what they meant first. He was a little uneasy, a little unsure, and then he got better and better and better. And that's the luxury you have if you do a full 90 minutes with somebody, that they relax, they begin to like you, perhaps. You make them comfortable if you're lucky enough. And then afterwards, they say, I don't know how you got me to tell that story about my divorce or how you got me to talk about whatever. Yeah, I'm sure you've had that where you just...
Well, how would you get them to do that? Was there something about just letting the breathe?
I'm not sure. Do you mind if I take a sip of this
sure,
coffee?
Sure, yeah, no problem, yeah.
Oh!
Your coffee has not arrived yet.
I know. I don't know. How did you dare start the show without my... By the way, did I tell you I just got off a plane from New York?
Absolutely.
I don't have any idea
here,
what
we're running the coffee right now.
You don't have to wait on me.
Yes, okay, absolutely. I'm happy to. I'm honored to.
God, Tom is waiting on me.
We'll just get rid of this here. We'll just put that over.
Yeah.
Oh, geez.
This is a violent show. I didn't realize. Where were we? The jet lag.
Yeah.
Harrison, well, you got better and better, and you asked me why that happens. I don't know how you got me talking about it. I think in my case, and let me finish the Harrison one, is this a jet lag symptom or not?
Sure.
He loosened up, and then he got really quite funny, and then at one point, it occurred to me that he was, and I told him, you're sitting in the chair that Yoko Ono was sitting in a couple of weeks ago, and he flew out of the chair. A nice moment in rock history. But I think because I had been a talk show guest, when I started out, they came and saw me in a club and said, he's not ready for the Tonight Show, even though I had been a writer there for years. So I was on Merv Griffin for several shots, as they say. So I knew what it felt like to be a guest. And I knew what makes a guest uncomfortable, and you do by now too, of course. But at first, you don't.
Mm-hmm. I think I make the guest uncomfortable a lot of the time.
Well, you're allowed because it's your show. Yeah.
But also
sticking to my notes too closely. Mm-hmm. You know, and somebody said to me once, "Did you hear what that guest had said?" Because you were changing the subject immediately with the, and I was so stiff and scared the first weeks. See if you can identify with this. It's as if a guest had said, and we scraped back the sand and we found this old trunk and we opened its rusty hinges, and Dick, you will never guess what was inside. And I said, do you have any hobbies? I mean, it was that bad.
Do you have any hobbies?
No, not since that moment.
We're going to get into this in more detail after the break. We have a break coming up. We're going to take calls from viewers on Skype. But you must just look back and think how you've met all of these icons, all of these legends. John Lennon, you've got to know Marlon Brando, you've got to know Groucho Marx. Is that just sort of a surreal thing?
It's again that phrase through the looking glass, because I worshiped these people as a kid. The strangest going through the looking glass was lying at home for summers and days and weeks watching the Ed Sullivan Show. And then we fade to black and I'm standing in the wings of the Ed Sullivan Show and go out and do my nightclub act. And I thought, how did little Dickie Cavett in Lincoln, Nebraska get on the Ed Sullivan Show? And I always wondered what those awkward looking things he said to the comic while the applause was going on. And Ed would hold the comic till the applause ended. Uh-huh. And the poor guy had to walk off in silence. Ed stood, looked like he was hanging on a coat hanger about 6 feet from you. Like this, Nixonian look. Nice man. But he was right here. You could almost reach him off camera. And I went over and I thought, I'm finally going to learn what Ed Sullivan says to people. And he said, nice to have you back, youngster. It was the only time I was ever on, the first time.
Yeah.
I knew that the way Ed's brain often slipped a cog. He meant to say, it's nice to have you on and we hope to have you back. But he kind of put it in a few words.
Well, it's great to have you back as well, sir.
Thank you. And I'll have your back as they attack us.
We're going to take a quick break and we'll be back with Dick Cavett. And joining us later in the show, Sammy Hagar is here and we're going to have some fun, probably drink some rum.
How come he got top billing?
Now we're back with Dick Cavett and...
And Tom.
Yes.
This is a very personal question.
Okay.
How do you pronounce the name of this city? I lived here once for 6 months. People would correct me. I noticed your announcer says Los Angeles,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
Some say Los Angeles.
I'm
Art
Canadian.
Linkletter, you say Los Angeles.
Okay.
There's no justification for that, is there?
Well, my as a Canadian, I'm probably saying it wrong, too. I just say Los Angeles.
Oh, it's not Los Angeles?
Not Los Angeles, oh, yeah. Let's do that. Yeah.
Okay. Let's start a new trend. I'm sorry, I wasted much of your time.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
I like to know where I am. We're not even there. We're in Burbank.
You like to do that, though, sometimes. I've noticed on the shows, to just kind of let it sort of sit for a second, let it breathe for a second.
That sometimes that's good. Sometimes I never thought of it as a conscious technique, but in watching a show back, if I did, I would think waiting a moment made the guest want to talk. Or often I found that a guest that didn't talk very much and it was painful, if you talked a lot, they suddenly thought, he's using up all my guest time.
Yeah.
And they would start to babble, and that's what you wanted. Yeah.
Is there just some sort of coincidence, or how is it possible that, you know, you're from Nebraska, Johnny Carson's from Nebraska.
Isn't that weird?
You guys met when you were young, quite young, right?
Well, I was quite young and remain so. yes, Johnny, I met when two little friends and I went backstage behind the curtain where he was setting up to do his magic act in a church basement in Lincoln, Nebraska, probably netting $30, having driven over from Omaha in his Chevy, where he was a huge star with a 15-minute radio show.
Yeah.
And we were kids in junior high, and he was a man. I remember we looked backstage, and Johnny gave us a filthy look, as any magician does when he's putting the dove inside his coat and setting the thing. And then I said, "It's all right, Mr. Carson, we're magicians." We were 13. And I said, "Oh, okay, fellas, come on over." And he was so friendly, and he showed us a new card fan that he was working on and some stuff. And he introduced us from the audience in the middle of his act, and we felt like we were on Ed Sullivan.
Yeah.
You know, when he would say, as it was to Gwen Verdon in a musical, he said, "Well, here she is in our audience, currently starving on Broadway." he meant starring, of course, but that was Ed.
Wow. Well, let's take a call from Joe in Massachusetts and on Skype, and open it up to the world. Joe, how are you? Do you have a question for Dick Cavett?
I'm doing great, thanks. Honored to be here. I was actually wondering, you guys were talking about awkward interviews. The Sly Stallone interview is one of my favorites. It was because he never really interviewed with anybody. Like, that was pretty exclusive, and it just was so awkward, but seemed to warm up so much. I was wondering.
Yeah, not anybody. There's an animal sneaking up on you. I feel I ought to tell you.
Yeah, that's George.
Oh, and he's got his Halloween costume on. Well, yeah, that was you've picked a wonderful example of gravelly, difficult conversation, but it was kind of, it got very funny after a while. And he made it up, I think someone made him watch that show that night, and he came back and did a swell show after that. But that was like pulling teeth and gums that one time. It set a record.
With Sly and
with
the Family
Sly.
Stone. Yeah, I watched that episode last night, actually, on your DVD. That was
it's on my rock DVD. Yeah. Isn't it funny? I hardly ever gave a damn about rock music back then, and I can't say I was around when it first came along, because you'd have to have been in deep Mississippi in certain places.
Sure.
With the Red Tops and legendary acts like that, but. They loved coming on my show, and I never could quite figure it out. And I got to like the people. And then we set a record one night. Do you know about this? The Airplane came on. That's a rock act, folks. And an ABC executive called me the next morning. He was shivering in his clothing. They had aired the night before on my show. And he said, "My daughter tells me that the F word was on our show last night." He had happened to miss the show. And it was.
Yeah.
But only rock people knew it.
Right, sure.
You know, up against the wall. From what song? What song of theirs is it?
Up against the wall. You can actually say it on here, too.
Oh, Father Mucker.
Yeah, yeah, you can say Father Mucker.
You can say Father Mucker. Yeah. I wouldn't say motherfucker on television.
Was there a lot of censorship? Did you have to battle the network at any point?
No, I won most battles. Nigger seemed to worry them in the, I think saying N-word is infantile. Uh-huh. We all know what the word is. It was in the title of Yoko's song when they came back on the show, stunning me by coming back. Woman is a nigger of the world, a philosophy of hers. And John said, Yoko one day said as a passing remark, you know, woman is treated as the nigger of the world. As one of the, ABC said, that song is not going to air. And I said, yes, it is. Not uh-huh. knowing what I meant by that.
Yeah.
And they worried. And I said, look, I get you two of the biggest rating nights in your life, and you're going to censor Lennon on my show, Lennon and Yoko. So they came up with a great idea. We'll have Dick tape, and the show was not coming on until 5 days later. We'll have Dick, in the time we have, tape a little segment saying there might be certain offensiveness to certain people in this, and we never want to offend him. Sappy little speech, and I recorded it as sappy as I could, mm-hmm. and they put it in. There were 400 complaints, none of them about the song, uh-huh. all of them about, as one woman put it, that dopey little mealy-mouthed speech you made Dick read off a cue card.
Right.
Before the song, can't you treat us as adults out here? Mm-hmm. So there's hope for America. Isn't that right, folks?
Yeah. you also had quite a bit of backlash from the Nixon administration, right? Where they were kind of concerned about...
Are you speaking of the great unindicted co-conspirator himself?
Yeah.
Yeah. If anybody here missed it, please see my Dick Cavett's Watergate special, which was on HBO about a couple weeks back. It is stunning. I can say that because brilliant people put it together. But a guy who works over here, Robert Bader, lives out here, going through my tape, said, you've got tons of Watergate. You had them all the wretched people in Watergate on the shows at the time. And I kind of kept the story going. Nobody else was doing it. I didn't realize it at the time. Wasn't my goal. But it's fun. I came out here one day and a guy got in the back seat of the car to take me to some award thing, and he flips open a laptop, and there is Richard Nixon in the Oval Office with his, this is an Elizabethan term, his lickspittle, H.R. Haldeman. We use real names here, don't we? And it's Cavett. Cavett. Mm. What is Cavett anyway? You can see this on YouTube. Mm-hmm. And they talk about it. Haldeman says, oh, we've complained bitterly about the Cavett show. And apparently being a non-Nixon fan was quite evident over the time.
Yeah.
And then at the very end comes the great line, Cavett, what can we do to screw him?
That's got to be pretty...
Now, anybody who thinks that doesn't sound like a president, wait till you hear the Nixon tapes.
Yeah.
He gets faggot, Jew bastard, and the word rainbow in one sentence at one point. His vile mouth must have had to do with his obvious obsession with his manhood, which we don't need a psychiatrist to work with. Because he was always saying, you know, he was a real man. I knew him. He was a real man. And the son of the president. I'll just get this in. I know you got to. We got Woodward and Bernstein, who came on my show back then, after the break-in. You're too young to remember all this.
Yep,
thrilling.
Sure. Heard about it, but yeah.
Thrilling time. As Gore Vidal says on the special, you woke up every day and you had to have your Watergate fix because it was just like a mystery story, working out with suspense. And it was Bernstein who says in the new interview, the day he took office after the landslide, after the re-election, instead of saying all the things we can do for the country now, isn't it great, let's remember to thank so-and-so, he's just saying, you know, this bastard, we're going to get him, we're going to wreck his business, we're going to put this guy out of there. And he did find a way to screw me in a way, but it was inept. One of his favorite criminal activities was to punish with the IRS. Mm-hmm. This is the president.
Right.
Bernstein's quote, from the first day of the second administration, it was a criminal administration because you had a president with a criminal streak of what, mile wide, which he exhibited and should have gone to jail for. And Agnew, his vice president, was also a crook. So we had the two top offices filled by people who should have been striped pajamas.
Wow.
But I'm sorry you were born so late.
Yeah, me too. 1971, I was born, so.
Oh, you're a baby, as they always say.
Okay, well, we'll take a quick break, and we'll be back talking with Dick Cavett, and joining us, Sammy Hagar. Stay tuned.
Sammy Hagar?
The Sammy Hagar. We'll be drinking some rum at some point soon, too. Yeah,
in the okay. show.
Yep. Back with Dick Cavett, and thank you for being here tonight. This is
I was in the neighborhood anyway.
Yeah.
You know, I take a walk here every night from my apartment in New York.
Are you here in town? Yeah. You're promoting the book?
I'm here. Yeah, I'm appearing with Paula Poundstone at the what's I'm sure you can find it in your list. What's the, it's a jet lag. I blanked on the name of the theater.
Okay.
The Huntington, the everything, the Huntington, and
go on the Google it.
Yeah, Google it. Cavett Poundstone.
Yeah. Now it must have been a lot of fun writing the book, though, just going through all these stories.
Well, when you read something, there's an audio book of it. In a way, it's better than the book, because someone pointed out, because they said you can imitate the voices of the people you talk about. I always have been able to. But the book has got so much good stuff in it. There's two sex pieces for people who like sex, there are some left, you know. The improbable thing of spending an afternoon with Stan Laurel of Laurel and Hardy in his apartment, a couple of very bad juvenile delinquent episodes from my past that will shock a couple of people.
I was surprised by that, actually.
Yeah,
I
seem so wholesome.
Yeah, I was surprised to see that you were brought into jail once with your friends.
You did read this. Yeah,
for tossing a rock through somebody's window.
Smashed somebody's glass door.
And throwing paint on the statue.
One little fink ratted on us, and we didn't know it. And then we found out that he had, and the cops played it cool. They were letting us stew for a couple of days. And then I had the brilliant idea, because my voice was not quite this low as a teenager and younger, but always very low. And people always said, you sound like your dad. And I had this great idea, and I called the cop who had arrested us from a phone booth, sweating, and said, officer, you did a brilliant job with these young men, and they're very, very repentant. They've collected money to pay the old people for their glass door. And I really have to commend you on your professionalism. Sweating, thinking, am I getting away with this?
Yeah.
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Had you paid for the glass door?
If he's watching now, yeah. I made this all up.
Yeah.
we did pay for the glass door. You would ask that.
Yeah.
Yes, I know.
I was wondering when I read the book whether you said you did, but
yeah,
maybe you actually
I should have mentioned that I did.
Yeah.
People cried in some of the pieces, and they were, when I wrote about the deaths of Jonathan Winters and my good friend James Gandolfini, better known as Tony Soprano. And it seems like there was a series of deaths that made people cry. Some people cried a little in the Stan Laurel two pieces, but he was wonderful, and he wasn't Stan Laurel of the movies, because that was obviously a character. And it was so strange to sit there and think, this is the man who, with the fat man, pushed the huge crate with the piano in it and lost it three times. Of those 133 steps that may be not far from here, they still exist.
Mm-hmm.
Stan told me where they were. The music box, the short that won an Oscar.
How does that feel when you've interviewed John Lennon, you know him,
yeah,
and then this horrific murder happens? You have a sense of personal connection there?
Yeah, that really hurt. I had the car radio on. I was driving out Long Island, and it came over the radio, and they said, John Lennon, and I thought, overdose, because I had lost, we all had, Janice, a few weeks later Jimi Hendrix from overdose, and I had so many dead rock stars on tape at one point, very early in their lives, that it was depressing. And John Lennon has been shot, and when you hear that, you don't know if he's dead, and you pull for he's alive, but it was obviously not. I had to pull over. I didn't cry. I just felt blank.
Mm-hmm.
and thought, this isn't true. He sat right here. He's got to be alive.
Yeah.
I've lost in a fire two letters he wrote me that were hilarious. He wrote, in his hero in literature was James Joyce, with the John's love for puns and things. And I had two nice letters from John. When I first met him, they wanted to see me before they did the show. So I went over to the St. Regis Hotel, thinking he probably won't do it. They've broken up, and you know. And there they were on the bed, John and Yoko. Not the way you're nodding your head thinking.
Not the lovin' in Montreal.
No, there were any kind of love. They had, John worked on the bed. He had folders and stuff, mm-hmm. projects. And I got a laugh, which broke the ice. He said, you know, you've got the only halfway intelligent talk show on television. And I said, why would you want to come on a show that's halfway intelligent? And he laughed, that hearty Lennon laugh. He was the most accessible person. He was just, so was Mr. Groucho Marx. Different, of course. He loved Groucho, by the way. But the moment you met them, it was easy conversation. You felt like you'd been friends for years. Your yeah. coffee is making me talk.
Yeah, that's great. That's perfect. That's good coffee. Let's get more of that. we're going to take a break. We're going to be back. Joining us will be Sammy Hagar. We're going to maybe have some of his amazing rum. And Dick Cavett will be sticking around, and we'll take some calls.
You keep promising Sammy.
Yeah, here he comes, right after the break. And we're back. Sammy Hagar is joining us. Sammy, thank you for coming in and bringing us a drink.
I thought you'd never get here.
I know. You know what? That's a whole other story, Dick. Don't start with me.
Why didn't you run out and tell me that they could see? Nothing looks worse than an old man's calves.
What happened?
Apparently it was visible all this time. No wonder nobody's watching.
I was going to wear shorts on the show because, you know, everybody knows I'm a beach nut.
You should.
And my kids, now I have 18-year-old daughters with me, and she goes, Daddy, you're not going to wear shorts. Daddy. She calls me Daddy
oh,
still.
Daddy.
I like it. It's cool because my wife doesn't, you know, so.
Yeah. Probably can't think of your name.
Well, she calls me like the old man. Like, you know, you call your wife the old lady, you know, right?
Yeah.
We're going the wrong direction. This is not way to start, Dick. Not with Dick Cavett on show.
That's okay. You got both sexes in that story.
Yeah, I did.
Something for everybody.
Yeah, don't bring up Yoko Ono again, though, because I was ready to come out. I thought you called me a name. I was sitting back. I'm hard of hearing, right? And you said something about Sammy Hagar is coming on, and you said something about, hey, well, why'd you put his name ahead of mine? And then all of a sudden you say about Yoko Ono, about, you know, the N-word.
Yeah.
And I thought he was calling me that. I was running. They held me back.
This was almost a Gord Vidal, Norman Mailer moment here.
Okay. I was ready to jump Dick
Cavett. You've had a few brawls on your shows
over here. By the way, speaking, more kids know me now than did when I was on television then. I think more people see me on YouTube than ever did in New Year's.
Of course, that's the new stuff, yeah.
I agree.
That show he's talking about was a fight between Norman Mailer, and Mailer really got me mad. He got Gore mad, he got everybody mad. And he went too far at one point, and here's why. He said, I'm bigger than any other people here, and I said, in what way is bigger? This is a real fight between authors. And he said, intellectually bigger.
Oh, that's fight words with Dick Cavett. See, what did I tell you when I walked out here? I said, this guy always went, if somebody like tried to outsmart him, I could see him working him. And then they would try to compliment him, and he would say some left-handed thing like, you know, you're really stupid for saying that. In his own kind of weird way.
I couldn't take a compliment. You're the first person to point that out to my face. Other people are more, you know, other people are polite.
But speaking of bigger,
But don't you want to know what
I
said to...
I love what you said.
Don't you want to know what I said to Mailer? You might want to use it. He said...
What, are you calling me a thief now? What?
Well, he said intellectually bigger, and I said, maybe you'd like another chair to contain your giant intellect. And this got a big last one. And this bit's on YouTube. And then he said the thing that I didn't know could make me maddest. As well as you know me, you might not guess. He said, why don't you just read the next question off the question sheet?
Ooh, and I for thought, Dick David, Cavett.
I thought David Frost. So I said, why don't you fold it five ways and put it where the moon don't shine? Now, there's nothing wrong with that, is there? That wouldn't offend you.
Have you said that to me?
Yeah.
I'd do it. Cheers.
Oh, boy. You know, I believe you.
This is called a 5150, by the way, because it's...
What is this?
This is...
5150 is a police code for the criminally insane. The first album I made with Van Halen, the name of Eddie's studio, a song I wrote with Eddie called 5150. It's about being uneven, right?
Is it?
So this is 51% white and 50% red.
It's got a kind of Kool-Aid, is it? Or?
This is not Kool-Aid.
This is rum. This is rum.
Brother, you know what? I'll tell you what.
Cheers.
Rum.
Go ahead, Dick. Bang it if it's Kool-Aid.
I get high on Celestial's tea.
Me too.
Now, Sammy, when did you become a...
Oh, this show is over for me.
Bullshit. You're going to interview me. Look, here's the whole thing. Rock stars, right?
Does your name ring a bell here?
he's interviewed every rock star. Come on, help me out. Tom,
yeah,
you got to be on my side.
Yeah,
Jimmy, every rock star in the world, all my heroes, now it's my turn.
Yeah.
Go.
Absolutely.
You guys switch it up.
When did
bit,
you become a liquor baron? You have this fantastic success in business with, started with tequila, with Cabo Wabo Tequila. And how did that happen?
I don't know. It's like, you know, I built this cantina in Cabo San Lucas called the Cabo Wabo Cantina, and I just built it, you know, to play acoustic guitar when I'm down there. I bought a home down there early on, like in 83, 82, before dirt roads, everything, you know, before telephones were there and all that. And so I built this little place where I could go hang out with my friends and eat tacos and drink tequila, because I was a big tequila fan. I'm not a big drinker, but I can drink, and I don't mind drinking, and I like to drink good stuff.
You know
how. I know how. There you go. It's kind of like the guy said about Coke. He's going, no, I don't do it, but I know what it smells like. You know what I mean? It's kind of like that. Well, I'm not one of those guys. Okay. But anyway, so so I built this place, and I wanted my own tequila. This was before tequila exploded. Back then, we were drinking bad tequila in America. So I went and found this tequila. It was unbelievable. These farmers were making their own personal brew that was, they'd sell the bad agave to the farmers and they'd keep the good ones for themselves.
Sure.
And they made it for me. So it started like that. And then all of a sudden, tequila exploded. I had a great tequila on the market, 100% agave, and it exploded and became the number two selling premium tequila in America. And I sold it by accident. I did not want to sell it. It was making me more money than I ever made in rock and roll. Truthfully.
Really?
Truthfully. More money every year than I ever made in the highest Van Halen, the biggest band in the world. Twice that, at least, per year.
Yeah. Now, you wanted me to interview, as they would say in Britain, let me ask you this. Did you, like your colleague Mick Jagger, go to the London School of Economics? Because you must be a businessman.
I didn't graduate from high school.
Yet?
No. I haven't yet. But I really didn't. I got kicked out my senior year. I could have graduated. It's not like I was a...
And here's your airplane that you just recently purchased from a Russian billionaire. We had a look at... Let's have a look at your plane. I popped by when you landed at the airport here in Burbank.
Just recently, but yeah.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
And for you.
Should we open one?
Let's open one, have one shot. One shot, just...
Straight out of the bottle, though. It's the only way to do it. I love Tom for this. Look at him. He's going to drink in a day.
No, it's all right.
Smell it first.
Tom Green is...
Ooh, that's... It smells like Hawaii.
Yeah.
You open that, it smells like Maui. You get off the plane in Maui, you start driving down the road, see a little rainbow, a little mist of deer, a little sun, a little rain. It smells like that.
Mm.
Pure cane sugar from Hawaii.
Rim shot.
That is nice.
Three-pointer.
That is nice.
Wow.
Yeah. White rum don't taste like that. White rum will put you in the hospital normally.
Yeah.
But this is...
That's really good.
Yum!
And that is...
this is what they call this is what they call educational television.
Is that... Okay, we're going to take a break, and we'll come back, and we'll talk some more. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Let's have a drink.
Wait. Hey, wait, isn't that the lick? You go
nice.
Like this.
There we go.
You go like this. He goes,
welcome back. Hey, this is good rum. This is great rum.
I feel I must report that you drank some more of it. Who's going to finish this show for you?
Yeah, I did top up the rum a little bit during the break.
Your face is getting blurred.
Yeah, absolutely. It happened. Well, I was surprised that do you drink since the Johnny Walker incident?
I
read in your book you tried some Johnny Walker at one point, and it was...
I became hideously drunk. Jerry Lewis gave everybody on an opening night of a show I was connected with a bottle of black label scotch. And I was depressed out in California because I didn't know any friends. And I drank three quarters of a bottle, pouring it into a paper cup and going like this.
Oh, well, that's too much.
Later that night, I went out to the swimming pool outside my apartment. Look at that. And I decided to jump in the pool with all my clothes on, like the Fitzgeralds in the 30s. But I had the presence of mind, drunk as a skunk, to take my nice unwaterproof watch off and put it in my pocket and jump in the water.
Nice, okay.
I crossed my heart.
The brilliance of Dick Cavett, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, you thought I was smart.
I will remember that later on tonight. I will remember that later.
Remember that. I like your hair, assuming it is your hair.
It is my hair. Ripped this month. That's I'm very fortunate, man. At my age, I'm 67 years old, and I'm got my full head of hair and my faculties.
What about
well, thanks
fetish.
For rubbing it in, Sammy. Okay, but no, let's see. Now, let me ask you, what was it like? What is it like to take over as the lead singer of an already huge band, Van Halen? What was that like?
It's not like anything.
Well, yeah. Well, the guy's still alive. It's not as cool. You know, it's like I was talking about that. I hosted an award show the other night, and I said, there they are. Look at this.
Yeah, look at
well,
that.
I just cut all my hair off because I just come off tour. And then Eddie Van Halen calls me up and says, hey, man, you know, Dave quit. You know, you want to join the band? And I'm going, well, not really, but sure, let's get together and play some music. You know, and it was all good. But the point is that the weird part about it is while the guy's still over there on the sidelines going, hey, I'm the lead singer in Van Halen, you know, you're going, no, you're not. We had 5 number one albums, 46 million records, or whatever it was. So it's a little bit weird while the guy's still alive. You know, it's really not that common that someone does it, you know, and gets away with it. You know, when the Bon Scott died and you know, AC/DC replaced him. And who else? Freddie Mercury, and now they got Adam Lambert, you know. That's a little easier gig.
Yeah, that's a little different too, I think.
Yeah. But we did fine. It's not like, you know, what? Like I was pressured because I don't really give a fuck. But that's different too, you know.
Ask him.
Most guys care.
What should I...
I really want to know this, and it's a question.
Great. I was going to ask if he could ask me just one question.
Absolutely.
I was interviewed by Dick Cavett.
I want to get your permission.
Absolutely. Please.
Okay.
That is the coolest.
Scorpion O'Leal, high five, and I like it. Okay.
I asked this of the late Betty Davis.
In case you got confused there for
well,
a second.
who worked just down the street at Warner Brothers, didn't she, all those years? Who's the worst prick you ever worked with in show business? Well, we're not on the air, are we?
Oh, shit.
I asked Betty Davis.
How about this for an answer?
Yeah.
I don't want to give him...
the satisfaction.
Me saying his name on TV. How about that? But what did Betty say?
Okay. I did that once on television. I said I worked with a jerk, a head, terrible, stupid head writer.
Say his name. And
his initials were Paul Keyes. I didn't mean that.
Dick is so cool. He's so cool, right?
You can
he's
use
slick.
That.
He's okay.
But
well,
really,
this guy's initials are. Well,
tell us some of his traits.
I swear. Big ego, a snake, a liar, a liar.
A Nixon, in other words.
Oh. Yeah. Well, it wasn't the President of the United States.
Oh, no. Oh,
I forgot who you interviewed and who I've been hanging around. Glad we hang in different circles, Dick. You know, the guy... I'm lion, you know, lion's a weird thing. I just got to get this off my chest. People that lie to you, you can't trust them. It's very simple. Profound, right? They lie, you can't trust them. So you say, hey, man... You know, what do you think should have happened with this or that? You know, and they tell you something, and you go, fuck, I can't even believe them. And it sounds true, but you still can't. You know, and they tell you the truth, and then you still can't believe them. That's messed up in a relationship, in my opinion. Yeah. Any kind of relationship, male, female, you know, kids, mom, dad, anybody lies to you, for me, out.
That's the password to going out.
You've said you would play with Van Halen again. No, what's your relationship with like now with Van Halen, with David Lee Roth?
Whoa, easy, brother. Whoa. You
know, people want to know. People want to know.
Well, think of this as a confessional.
People want to know. I mean, you were.
I have no relationship right now with anyone in Van Halen except for Michael Anthony, who was thrown out of the band because he was my friend. Those guys are kind of treacherous, you know. You can only get, excuse the words, but fucked so many times by somebody before you go, man, I don't want to deal with them anymore. So that's the way I feel about Van Halen.
You see that as a negative, do you?
Yeah, I do.
Yes.
So I have no relationship with him, and I'm cool with it. Don't get me wrong. The body of work stands for itself. Fantastic, killing, proud of it. High point of my musical career, absolutely. I had a couple platinums before him, had a couple platinums after him, but that was multi-platinum, all number ones, selling out every stadium in the world. So that was big, it was all good, and probably helped me be the confident person I am today. I'm saying I'm okay.
Yeah.
But to go back with people that you can't trust, I'm sorry, I can't do it. Okay. Not at my age, come on.
All right, let's take a quick call from Graham in Massachusetts. Graham in Massachusetts, you are...
I like these calls.
Let's get some people on the air to talk to you here.
Oh, Graham, what's up?
Graham,
he might want to talk to Dick.
Graham with your Sister Act poster in the background, what is your question?
You think
he's
so?
He's more your type.
Sammy.
Yeah, oh, I thought you wanted to talk to Dick. All right.
From one red rocker to another, I'd love to know what rock acts you're digging these days. Who is actually floating your boat out there?
Oh, well, hey. I'd say that they... I'm sorry.
I just did an award show, the Classic Rock Award Show, and the opening act for the whole thing is the Rival Sons, and they are throwbacks to Led Zeppelin, to my first band, Montrose, and they're just awesome, and I love them. I know the guys. I took them on tour with me the last time I toured, and the Rival Sons, I really think they are the future of that kind of rock, and
that's a clean answer.
That's great. Oops. That's great. Yeah. We are going to take a break, and we'll be right back. Stay tuned. One more act.
Are we having any fun yet? Wait.
We got one more chance to be good. We have now.
Everybody at home, have a drink.
He's going to do a rope trick?
I have one.
Genius. But,
You
have.
You mean like you climb a rope?
Can we talk while we do it?
You've got soft rope.
Okay, then him and I'll talk, and you like get this act together.
Well, Dick is an amazing magician.
See this? Are we on the air?
Yeah, we are back on the air. We're back with Dick Cavett.
I'm trying to get my rope untangled.
Hey, take your time, Dick. It's all good.
I'll just do part of it. You got a scissors?
Yeah. We'll go over time.
Scissors.
I know the guy that owns this network.
We have scissors. Yes, we do have scissors.
Hey, come on. I'll call Mark.
No scissors, and this act is over.
Do I need to call Mark Cuban if we need a little more time on this in case we go over? I'll
call Mark. More time, right? Hey. You guys just keep talking. I'll do a rope.
Okay. So
this is the first.
How you been, Tom?
Yeah. Let's have a look real quick here.
Okay. Well. I forget how I started it now. Let's see. I'll give you some scissors.
Yes, sir.
And I'll just pull a rope through my fingers, and you say stop when you want to say stop.
Oh, sure.
Anytime you want to say stop, just say stop.
Stop.
Okay. So we cut the rope where you said stop.
Right there.
Yeah. That's good. Oh shit. They're supposed to be the same length.
Ain't this a bitch? You want me to cut it there?
Wait a minute. Well, they're. I don't know what they're gonna do now. Wait a minute. Well, that's better. Now here's the.
Wait a minute.
Now watch. You be careful. This is what's called a beautiful move in magic.
Okay.
They're supposed to be the same length. You screwed me up. I'm gonna have to start over with one piece of rope.
Oh. All right. Hey. You know what?
Oh, cheers.
And
cheers.
Work for the booze. Cheers. I'll pop that.
Cheers. You know? Dick, have another drink with us for that one.
By the way, it's a routine. It has five more parts.
Oh, well, that is. If we didn't have our buzz on, he'd have never got away with that. I'd have found it. I've seen it.
You guys tried to upstage me.
That was amazing. I wanted to ask.
I love this guy, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is so great.
We're only good friends. But
yeah. This is so great having you both here. I mean, this is. I think, you know, I'd like to thank our crew here and everyone at AXS TV for giving me the opportunity to do what we're doing tonight, which is to sit here with two legends in their own field and hang out and have a conversation, which is something that is rare.
And the
rare.
Fact that we both look alike. Is
yeah.
When's your birthday, Dick? Not year. Date. November.
In German? 19
he's
November.
He's a Scorpio. I'm telling you, I knew this from the old days.
He I've been sensed it.
Yes.
He sensed
no,
it.
I knew it because I, when yeah. old days when I
what
was watching
the
your
secret
show.
To longevity in this business? Both of you have reinvented yourself. You've done multiple versions of your television show. You've been in multiple
yeah.
bands.
We think of ourselves as just getting started. I
yeah.
mean, and we're just knocking at the door.
How do you keep it going for an entire career, for an entire lifetime of work in this business?
Screwing everybody you can.
Oh, no. Oh, Dick, let me down.
Well, you
no.
told me to say that.
That was the first time we met, though. I've changed since then. I believe that
no,
if you
no.
ever screw somebody, then you're going to have to deal with people that have screwed other people. So
yeah.
I try not to, either everybody wins or I'm saying, I'm out of this one, you know?
Well, that, was, like, my, that was my Nixon imitation. Screw everybody you can. Which he did.
I think longevity, on a serious note, Dick won't do it. Let me do it for you, okay?
Yeah,
on a serious note, I think it's doing all kinds of things you still have passion for. If you don't have any passion, then it's an exercise. It's like Picasso going, I don't care. And it's going to be great. But it's not going to be as great as the ones that he's going, man, into it, really into it. So it's all about
yes.
what you dig. You know, if you dig something or really dig it, you know, and like doing it, then you just keep doing it and you find something else you like doing. I get thrown out of bands all the time, so I'm always in a situation where I have to do new things because I get
yeah.
thrown out of bands. I don't know.
But see if you agree with this, both of you.
But it's a good thing. It makes you healthy.
Yeah. I think
Start
one thing
over.
That should be
yeah.
stamped out is the people who tell young folks, find out what your passion is and work hard and sacrifice, do everything you need to do and you dedicate yourself to it. And if you do that long enough, you will succeed. Bull.
See, I knew he would shoot me down. See, that's Dick's trip.
No,
he's
that's
sarcastic.
Well,
that's kind of what I said.
You said you have to genuinely believe in what you're doing.
Oh.
But to say if you work hard, you'll get there. Like
well,
hell,
hard work doesn't
you know,
hurt.
40,000 women wanted to be Katharine Hepburn, but only Katharine Hepburn got to do it.
So you think there's so it's a combination of natural,
yeah.
innate talent, hard work, and a bit of luck.
Yeah, and none of and they might and then it might not work. So don't break the kids' hearts when they think, "What's
God,
wrong with me? I did
so
all those
optimistic.
Things and I didn't make it."
I just love these optimistic people. You know.
Yeah.
But is it has it been? You did 7 versions of the Dick Cavett Show?
I think so. Every time a Cavett Show was canceled, Johnny would have me on.
Uh-huh.
He's a Scorpio, too, by the
yes,
way.
Yes,
there
that.
You go. I do
the
that.
The following Monday, Johnny would have me on and say, if this next one doesn't work, it's going to be Armed Forces Radio for Richard.
Hey, that voice, I'm sitting in the back in my dress. Now I got to become a fan. And I'm just hearing Dick's voice. I mean, people... Hopefully, on your show at the end of the liner notes, you're going to show all the voiceovers that he's done in his life. Because it's like growing up, I'd be like in the other room, oh, that's Dick Cavett.
Yeah.
I'd be in there like, you know.
That's a mixed blessing, you know, because there are times when you're
can't get
talking
away with
to
nothing.
Someone at the airport and people 9 feet away say,
we're
we know who you are and we heard what you said.
Or the wife hears
Mr.
you talking,
Cavett,
you know, to somebody else.
Mr.
Hey,
Hagar,
baby.
Thank you.
You know,
we
yeah.
have... Oh, we're done.
Buy more time.
We want more
hey,
time.
Hey, Mark,
hey,
give us another
getting,
half hour. Mark,
yes,
come
absolutely.
On.
We're just getting loaded and warmed up.
Thank you. Dick Cavett, Sammy Hagar, thank you. Thank you. Good night, everybody.
The first hour and a half Tom Green show ever. The first hour and a half Tom Green.